Hello, multi-musical Mogwai monsters. Welcome to Ralfy Review 961 Extras. And welcome to... To Mike Stitch for the Malt Mansion. I'm Ralfy, here in the Bothy, bringing you an Extras. An Extras is additional information to help you navigate the world of whiskey. Now, I've got a bottle here, and I want to read you the tasting notes. It's quite a nice whiskey, although personally I find it a little bit oaky. It's got that American generic oak thing going on. It's Arran Quarter Cask, a non-aged statement, single malt of pretty decent quality, so long as you like a little bit of fresh American oak in your whiskey. Quite nicely presented here, in my opinion, a little too much of it, but hey ho, that's my opinion. Now, in their opinion, right, although it's being formally delivered on the label, they've provided tasting notes for this whiskey. I quote, aromatic and intensely fruity with tropical fruits and coconut, warming spiced vanilla and gourmet apple notes. Arran Distillery have kept their taste descriptors fairly compact and concise. They're using the words aromatic, fruity, gourmet apples. That's the biggest ambitious portion of their tasting notes. What exactly is a gourmet apple? I presume that it's an in-season, healthy apple that hasn't been dosed with a whole load of sprays that you buy in a farmer's market that actually has flavour. Because the majority of apples that we buy from a supermarket are flavourless. They look lovely, but they're flavourless because they've been designed to be that way. Flavour costs money. And people tend to look at products with their eyes and they use their imagination to fill in the flavour which isn't actually there. Now, the thing with Scotch whiskey and other good quality spirits is that too much whiskey's there, too much flavour's there. It's confusing, it's baffling. It's not just the flavours, this concentration and cordial of flavours. It's the sensations that go with these flavours, the complex fusion of sensations, sweet, salt, sour, bitter and savoury. And then at the end of it, you've got the form of the whiskey. How strong is the arrival? How long is the development? How sustained is the finish? That contributes to the physical dimensions of the actual taste experience, which is really the form, most of the form. So even a relatively simple whiskey for someone who's spent most of their life eating processed foods and buying food out of supermarkets, it can be a real shock to the palate. This is one reason why lazy drinkers put ice in their whiskey. They're not cooling the drink because they want a cool drink. All what they want to do is suppress the flavour. This is why so many of these generic modern beers are served cool and chilled. And you look at the draft tap on the bar and it's got sort of condensation running down it and bits of icicles, you know, in plastic. Because the brewers want you to drink cold beer because it suppresses the inferiority of the ingredients and the production methods so as they can make higher profits. And this is why real ales and real beers are served just slightly lower or at room temperature, because then you can access the flavours. It's the same with whiskey. And as soon as you take your ice cubes out, you're accessing that flavour and you're wondering what the hell's going on. So this is where tasting notes can be useful, if they're honest and if they're focused specifically on the readily identifiable components of the whiskey. So, for example, when I see something like intensely fruity, you know, most whiskies are actually intensely fruity, but it's honest. It's an honest descriptor. You know, it's preparing you well. Whereas if you see another descriptor that says the crashing storms of transatlantic gales buffeting the Islay coastline and scattering the seashells as birds wheel and fly overhead and lightning strikes the bends and glens, and that's frankly disingenuous bullshit. It's telling you nothing. It's purely suggestive. And I would honestly say that the person writing these sort of descriptors for the whiskey is frankly taking the piss out of you. So you really want to ignore that. And you do find in some distilleries, they do take themselves seriously. They do get very fanciful with their tasting notes, and this will cause you confusion. Therefore, what you want to do is, if you're looking at the tasting notes provided by the manufacturer on the label of a whiskey, rum, bourbon, or anything, just pick out the basics from them, the key words in the paragraph. Pick it out and say, right, I'm looking for fresh, fruity, maybe some apple and tropical. Right. Keep it simple. KIS, keep it simple. Now, at this point, you might want to practice a little bit. You're tasting the whiskey, and the more you taste it, the more your senses get used to it. And the more you move from a position of the irrational and subconscious interpretation of the experience to the informed, rational, objective, and constructive experience, simply because you're getting to know the bottle over time, because your nose and your taste buds are simply getting more experience of it. It's just like riding a bicycle. The first few turns of the pedal, you're going all over the place. But once you get a little bit of momentum going and you know that your brakes are working, off you go. So the next point you might want to do is, you get more confident, you've got the few basic tasting notes, and you're looking for something a little bit more insightful, you'll go online. You may buy a book, and the book will give you some tasting notes, but they tend to be very generalized and very homogeneous. So you'll go online and you'll find a reviewer, whether it be a blog reviewer, a vlog reviewer, or a Reddit reviewer, or a Facebook reviewer. There's so many options out there, and everybody's voice really matters, because everybody's adding to a consensus here. And what you'll notice is a tremendous variety of opinions actually coming together on the same... Hello, Billy. You coming up to see me? Oh, how you doing, pal? Billy the cat. How you doing, mate? Am I gonna get a hug? No, I'm not gonna get a hug. I very rarely get a hug, but fortunately, my two cats, Billy and Fluffy, are not into whiskey, which is good. They leave my whiskey alone, although I can't leave my bottle sitting in the carpet, because when they bring mice in for their dinner that aren't quite dead, they want to chase them around the carpet, and if there's any bottles in the way, the bottles get scattered like skittles in a 10-pin bowling alley. Don't they, Billy? Yeah, naughty tomcat. He's a great personality, actually. Come on, give me a hug. A wee sniff of the whiskey. Right, that's all you're getting. Right, off you go. And stop bringing mice into the house, or I'll lock you out at night, and you'll have to come down sleep in the bothy. Because if you're sleeping in the bothy, I know there'll be no mice here, or anything larger and more dangerous. Anyway, I'm allowing myself to get distracted here. So you'll go online, and what you'll start to get is perspective and opinion from various sources. And this is where you'll find that people have a different take on a whiskey, or a bourbon, or a rum. It may be similar, but it's slightly different. And this is where you see that people's sense of taste perception actually varies. And this should encourage you to be more confident and more assured about your own. And because having slightly non-orthodox senses of taste, it's not a bad thing at all, actually. In fact, having too good a sense of taste can be problematic with whiskey, because all the bad elements of a whiskey jump out at you, and then you get to the point you can't really enjoy it anymore. And you end up, you'll try rum, the same thing will happen there, then Armagnac, and then bourbon. And then you end up walking away and remaining stone cold sober 100% of the time. And who wants that in their life? How boring. So you don't want too good a nose and too good a palate. You want to average. And most of all, you want to approach it with the knowledge that you're going to enjoy it. You're going to find the good bits about it and you're going to focus on them. Whether it be the fact that it be unchilled filtered, whether it be the fact that it be nice, rounded, fruity, unpeated, and maybe there's a little bit of an awkward note in there or an awkward sensation, bitter or sour perhaps. But you can deal with that, you accommodate it. And in a sense, your mind will actually start to edit it out slightly to allow you to enjoy the whiskey, so long as it's not too dominant. And this is the way you grow your palate, so that it comes a point where you read the tasting notes in a bottle and you say, yeah, that's all very well, but I'll be deciding. Because you've got enough confidence in your own palate. And the way you can practice building up your palate is by slowing down and eating a wider range of kitchen prepared foodstuffs and beverages. Tea, coffee, you know, it's not just breakfast tea or fermented tea. There's so many other teas out there. And if you have a little bag of, say, peppermint tea, chamomile tea, rosehip tea, when you experience these teas rather than just the one particular brand of tea, you're starting to diversify your references of flavour. And ultimately, after a few years, you start to no longer enjoy things you used to enjoy. You start to notice that you're getting tired of sugary, bland consumables like Coca-Cola, obvious example, or generic ice cream. You start to notice that, in fact, what you thought was flavour is, in fact, just a dominant sensation. And the dyes, the food dyes they've put in to give ice cream, for example, a certain colour, make you think that it's strawberry or chocolate or vanilla. And yet when you really taste it, you think, hang about, where's the flavour? And the flavour's not there because flavour costs money. And the more money that the producers spend in the product, the more they undermine their profits and their profitability. Therefore, to get brand acceptance from people out in the market with all the palate varieties, it actually pays them to have as little flavour in as possible. So that when you buy fresh fruit, fresh veg, fresh seasonal fruit, when you buy good quality wines, when you buy good quality teas, when you walk past Starbucks and go into the local coffee shop who actually grind their own beans fresh, the difference will be tangible. And you're educating yourself not just in discovering the flavour of whiskey, but discovering the flavour of life. Because life is full of flavour. And yet we are being groomed, we are being chaperoned and conditioned by society to deflavour our lives in order to be homogenised and generalised and averaged out. But thank goodness, nobody's told whiskey about this. And there's very rarely, unless it's a particularly innocuous blend, there's nothing vague, average and homogenised about a decent single malt Scotch whisky. So we must keep the faith, malt mates. Yes, we must. And our responsibility is not just to enjoy the whisky, but to practice out there in the real world with the foods we eat, the drinks we drink, to explore different flavours, different food styles, to increase the library of our palate. So when we taste it in whisky, we'll recognise it, and we'll recognise it on our own terms, and we will no longer be needed to be chaperoned and groomed and guided by other people's tasting notes. I hope you've enjoyed this. If you have, subscribe if you haven't. It's always nice to have you checking out my videos. I'm Ralfy from the Bothy, and you are wonderful. Bye-bye.